Hi guys, I'm so happy I can make these videos. I want to thank you all for the amazing support and feedback I get on my videos. Makes me very happy. Every time I post a video, I get so many comments from you guys, and some of them are very interesting and challenge me or inspire me, and I think that's so awesome. So Bitcoin and the cryptocurrency market has rebounded quite strong in a couple of days, from 250 billion to 330 billion. And of course, there's always the risk that we've seen the low, and that we go from here up or sideways for a while, up and go into a new bull market, even possible this year, reaching the all-time high. That's why I have an exposure to crypto, always have, even at the top, a very big one. 3-4 months ago, it has gone down a lot, my exposure, because it corrected strong, and now it goes back up. My exposure to crypto, I didn't check it lately, but it's probably around 30 or 40%. That's pretty high. It used to be 60, 70% at the peak. And so even when I'm wrong, and I will be proven wrong if the market goes up from here, because I think, well, probabilities are in favor for the market to continue to go down for the rest of the year, and that this will very likely be just a rebound to about 400 billion, as we have seen in the bear market of 2014, where it also correct with almost 70% for a couple of months, from 15 billion to 5 billion, and then it went up from 5 billion to about 8 billion, so adding about 50% for a couple of months, and then it went down and found a new low at 3 billion. I think that's the most probable to happen again. But is it that probable? No, that exact pattern is not that probable, but it's more than 50%, but I wouldn't say 90, maybe it's 51 or 60. The question is not how high will it rebound, but for me, because I don't trade, so I'm just looking for an entry point here. For me, the question is how probable is that we will go lower than the 250 billion we've seen, or than the 330 billion we're now, and should I panic buy now, or should I be patient and play the odds? And of course, I think that I should be as objective as possible when estimating probabilities, and so that's why I re-evaluate constantly whether I'm right or not in estimating these correctly. For example, Pantera Capital just made an interview report that they think that we've seen the low and that it's up from here. Okay, that's interesting. So I do some more research in Pantera Capital. Turns out they said exactly the same when it reached the first time 250 billion market cap, or $6,500 for Bitcoin. That was already reached early February. That was the first crash, and then it rebounded strongly from 6,000 to 12,000 almost, and then it collapsed again to 6,500, 7,000 a couple of weeks back. So on that first crash, is it the same, that this probably was the low? So okay, I haven't checked their other calls, but for me, and also what are the arguments that they give, why they think we've seen the low here? They say that that for example, average bear market lasts only 60 days, and we're now 70 days or 80 days in. Well, that's just not correct. The average bear market does not take 60 or 70 or 90 days. No. They are counting corrections during a bull market as a bear market. That's not correct. There only have been two bear markets in the past in Bitcoin, not more than that. So And in 20, that was in 2011 when it corrected for half a year, and in 2014 when it corrected for 1 to 2 years. So the average, if you take those, is like 3/4 of a year. But that's also not how you should look at it. You should look at what is the pattern in the cycles, the cycles are extending. You have shorter bull markets in the beginning, shorter bear markets, longer bull markets, longer bear markets. So we had just the longest bull market ever in crypto, lasting from the low, $200 early January 2015, to the high in December 2017. That's 15, 16, 17. That's 3 years bull market. That's the longest ever. The one before was only 2 years, 2012, 2013. And the one before was, well, you could say certainly shorter than 2 years, because it only started trading in 2010, and so that was maybe a year of bull market. So 1 year, 2 years, 3 years bull markets we've seen. And in the bear market, it's the same pattern. Half year bear market, one year bear market, and now it's probably going to be longer than 1 year. Things can always be different, patterns can be broken, but as an investor, you have to invest based on odds, and that's based on past performance. And then you can say, oh, but past performance is so short, you cannot base yourself on that. Well, it's true, it's short, it's only 10 years for cryptocurrency past performance, that's very short, but it's the best we have. So it's better to look at that than not to look at it at all. But you shouldn't give it that high of a probability than studying past performance of stock markets where you can go back many hundreds of years, or gold. So you can study cycles that go back 200, 300 years. Yeah, that will give you a lot more reliability in estimating probabilities than a 10-year track record. It's the same when you study investment managers and fund managers, the same story there. Or girls, girlfriends, or boyfriends. The longer you can go and study the track record, the better. Yeah, that's one thing. Another thing is that that I'm still studying a lot where to invest my crypto profits, and I'm looking into gold and gold mining stocks and uranium mining and the commodity cycles. But the one big thing that concerns me there is that we have not seen a period of declining production yet in these sectors. Gold production has continued to go up from what I've found. And the same for uranium production. Gold production at current valuations, gold $1,200, $1,300, is profitable for many gold miners. So, of course, then gold production will continue to go up. For uranium, at $20 a pound, it's not profitable anymore. Even the lowest cost producers for uranium, that's in Kazakhstan, are running at a loss, so they claim, because you always have to be careful. Miners will quickly say that, but as long as they continue to produce more, well, it seems that they are not losing enough. So it's only really declining production that will prove to you that the commodity is actually really cheaper than the production cost. And so in Kazakhstan, for example, they start to cut production. And now we will have to see if that also really happens and has an influence on world production. But it seems that it's leveling out in 2015-16. The rise in production has indeed started to flatten. And if indeed the numbers are out for 2017 and it starts to decline, okay, that's a good thing. But you see that in past cycles, actually it declines not for 1 year, but for 5 to 10 years. Same in gold. About 5 years declining production, and only after that you see the actual real low of the price. So that's what concerns me in these sectors. And also another thing is that the reason why I am interested in for example, the uranium sector is not because of uranium. No, it's because of nuclear power. I believe in nuclear power, that's the future. That that the amount of energy density in uranium and plutonium and rhodium is a million times higher than the energy density you can find in our best one is gas or oil, and there it's also higher than in, for example, coal, and coal is higher than wood. So every time humanity has done has upgraded to a new form of energy with a higher density, that has resulted in massive growth for humanity. When we transformed from wood into coal, it was a massive change in society, and it was all thanks to having cheaper form of energy as the driver of civilization. And so when it then went from coal to oil, that also changed society totally and lowered the cost of energy, and therefore lowered everything in costs, transportation, food production, construction, everything. And so the same will happen when we transfer from basically what we have today for energy production is still coal and gas is the biggest ones. Wind and solar are really not gaining any percentage, even though 10 years massive amounts of money has been pumped in, because it's so unreliable. The amount of energy you get from it is low because more than half of the time there is no wind or no sun, and storage has a huge problem. A storage problem is not solved, and so you see that basically there is actually strong growth still in coal and in gas plants to create actually the rise of electricity demand that we need. But this is not the right direction, and I think it's a very interesting team nuclear, because most of society is wrong there and thinks that it's bad and it's not the future, but it's the inverse, it's the future. But okay, the first generation nuclear plants have their problems. The waste is the biggest problem. It takes thousands of years for the waste to become not radioactive anymore. And safety is also a concern. But what you see now is that that the next generation nuclear plants are just really already super, super, super exciting and great, great improvements on what's being built today. And the next generation is generation 4. And Bill Gates, for example, with the company that he founded 10 years ago, TerraPower, with some other people, is really ahead there and has its first deal with the Chinese government to build a test plant where they will prove the technology, because it's just theoretical now, computer simulations. But if it works out, it will be a nuclear plant or test plant here that burns, that runs on uranium waste, nuclear waste. And so there's plenty of that you can get for free. And it will burn that, and it will do so. There are some other innovations also. The waste that will come out, so after the process is finished, whereas now this radioactive waste is radioactive for thousands of years and need to be stored securely for such a long time, after it's coming out of this generation 4 reactor, it will only be radioactive for 100, 200 years, 300 years tops, and then it's not radioactive anymore. So that really reduces the waste problem a lot. Also, it will be a closed cycle, meaning that it does not need to be refilled, because that's a dangerous process when you need to open the reactor and put in new fuel. Well, here that will not be necessary. The reactor will not be able to be opened up to refill with fuel, because the fuel will burn 30 to 60 years, and then it's also the end of the life cycle of the plant, of the reactor. And so That's also a great safety improvement, but also reduces costs a lot. And then there's also that it will not need cooling from outside, from water, and it will just be able to cool itself off. So in case of an emergency, a natural disaster, earthquake or tsunami, when there's a problem detected, it will shut itself down, and it will not need to be dependent on external cooling to be to cool off, which is very important and caused the disasters in the past. So these three innovations make that this nuclear plant will run cheaper, but also solves the problem, the safety concerns and the waste concerns, and so makes it suddenly just extremely attractive for governments and utilities to build. Another big advantage here is that there's not the risk that nuclear weapons will be produced, because with nuclear plants, what nuclear plants need is not just uranium, it needs enriched uranium. And so what it needs to do is basically take a whole pile of uranium and put it through centrifuges and concentrate the uranium or enrich it. And so it makes from a lot of uranium, a little bit uranium, but enriched. And this is also what you need to make a nuclear bomb. You need enriched uranium. And so you just need to enrich it more than is needed for a nuclear plant, but it's the same process. And so, building a nuclear plant is also a political thing, and many countries are forbidden to build nuclear plants, or they will be or they are seen as a threat. But if you build a generation 4 nuclear plant, you're not increasing your capability to build nuclear weapons. No, because you don't need an enriched uranium. You just need waste uranium. So that's also a big advantage. So I think these kind of innovations may really revive the industry, because what we see today is that there's a very negative mood around uranium or nuclear plants, and many politicians decide to shut them down prematurely in the West, which is of course really it's terrible decision making, absolutely the wrong decision making, because the story is that that wind and solar replace it, but the actual truth is that gas plants and coal plants are ordered immediately to be built the moment a nuclear plant is ordered to shut down, because wind and solar cannot replace a nuclear plant shutting down. So that's what happened in Germany, for example. They decided to shut down all nuclear plants by 2024 or so. That's 17 of them. And at the same time, a little bit later, they authorized 23 new coal plants to be built. So that's a real disaster for the environment and for the health of population, because even though coal plants and gas plants are the best we have, compared, it's much better than an oil plant, or than it's even better, in my opinion, than solar panels. I mean, it does provide massive amounts of energy at a very cheap price, but it comes with a lot of air pollution. And so this can be avoided with nuclear plants. But also, the potential is so much more with nuclear plants. The nuclear plants we see now, like even this generation 4, the fourth generation, okay, this is a lot of improvements, but in the end, there can be done so much more. These are still fission processes, but you can actually go to fusion processes, where the amount of energy you get out of the plant is 1,000 times higher than current nuclear plants. So that's the potential, and this is absolutely impossible to achieve with coal or gas plants or with solar or wind. So that's the future, and it will take a while before we get there. But the first step is to see a revival of the nuclear industry, because fusion plants were not... Well, there are actually busy with that. The first one test plant is being built in France by a bunch of nations. But still, you need a revival of the nuclear industry to get to these kind of innovations. So the first step here is that politicians stop shutting down nuclear plants and start ordering more instead. And that will only happen when the population changes their negative view on nuclear plants. And for that, it will take a couple of years of evangelism. And I think we can be a leader in that, like so many people are starting to do. If you look for information about nuclear, you will find a lot of environmentalists, for example, that were strongly against it in the 80s, 70s, 80s, 90s, changing their mind and are really promoting nuclear. So, but this will take like 5 to 10 years probably to see that kind of narrative change on nuclear, and only after that politicians will start again probably to order them in the West. But still, nuclear is still today a fast-growing industry, even though you have these shutdowns. The amount of new nuclear reactors that's just coming online the next 5 years that are in construction now, it's about 50, and there are about 500 worldwide operational. About 50 will come online the next 5 years, and about, I don't know the exact numbers, I think about 150 are planned or so, but not being built yet. But so even though you can see in the West some of them shutting down, on a net scale, probably the amount of nuclear reactors operational is still going up and continues to go up thanks to China, India, Brazil, like developing countries, or actually not developing anymore. China is now the biggest economy in the world, bigger than the US. So the new countries that really need cheap, clean energy and can't be fooled by these false stories that coal or gas would be better. No, they see the massive pollution from that in those places, and they can't, and they are really like building nuclear plants. But of course, they are afraid also from these disasters that just happened in Japan also. I really suggest studying these, because there's a lot of hysteria around these disasters also. The amount of radiation, for example, is not as high at all as claimed. The amount of people that die from the radiation, also not at all. We're talking about 10 to 50 people that really are usually part of the emergency crew that has to clean up everything, or has to... firefighters, or that they do get too much radiation and die or get cancer, but for the population around these new reactors, that has not been the case from the studies that's been done. This is really there's a lot of hysteria around it also. Like, we think, if you don't think about it, like I think also too, there's a nuclear plant here also, not far from where I live. Oh, if that explodes, what will I do? How fast can I get away here? Do I need pills to protect myself? But it's not like that at all. A nuclear plant is not a nuclear bomb. This is really a total misrepresentation that was was done in the 70s by the Greenpeace and all the environmentalists, really giving the wrong image of what of the dangers, the true dangers of a nuclear plant going wrong. So, I keep on talking because I think it's very fascinating. But so I'm interested not in mining uranium. That's not what I believe will make the big change here. No, it's about really building nuclear plants and building new generation nuclear plants. That's what's going to change the world. And some of them will run on nuclear waste, so they won't need any new uranium. Others will run on thorium or plutonium, or there are other sources also. So it's not the uranium story that I'm really attracted to. I'm attracted to the nuclear power plant story. And so, for example, I think a very interesting investment could be TerraPower, the company founded by Bill Gates and some other people that has now a first contract to build that test plant. Yeah, that's an interesting investment, because if these guys succeed, they're going to get orders to build plants everywhere. And there's a strong, there's, you could say, some kind of network effect here in that, well, it is. I mean, you're not going to commission any company to build a nuclear plant for you. You really need a lot of trust. And so the winner takes it all. Well, not all, but probably 50% of the market. And continues to do so. So I think that if everything works out, companies like TerraPower, and there are some competitors also, I will post the link to a chart below. But these guys may really receive over the next 10, 20 years a lot of orders to build plants, and may really be able to ask huge profit margins on them and still get the job, because, well, you know, for a government or a utility ordering a plant, a nuclear plant, it's not about the price that much. It's also about the trust a lot, and being sure that they will be able to execute it and build it safely. So that would be a great investment, but it's not a listed company. It's a private company, so I have no idea if that's even possible to invest in that. But these kind of companies, I think, will have potentially much, much, much higher returns than an uranium miner, who could be, well, you know, the uranium price may stay low for a long time, and still this revolution could happen. Actually, no, I do think that there is a good odds for uranium to go up in price, because it's pretty low, but uranium miners might give a lot less returns than these nuclear plant builders. So I haven't made a decision yet to invest, but I'm still researching. So voila, that was a little update of what I'm busy with. Thank you all for watching, and I'm looking forward to read your comments. Bye.